Okay, we are live. Welcome to Tamarah's Closet today. I have a wonderful artist with me today. I'm really excited about having her with me here today because I discovered her a few weeks ago in American Art Collector magazine, and I was really thrilled when she agreed to be my guest today. I have found her work very healing to me, and she's got a really unique story and technique that she uses with some of her artwork, which I'll have her share with us today. So she's made it her life's work to paint about history and healing. She's a graduate of the George Washington University with a degree in fine art. She's exhibited her work in venues nationwide, including Target Gallery in Alexandria, Virginia, and the Masur Museum of Art in Monroe, Louisiana, both awarding her the Juror's Award, Aqua Art Miami, a solo at the Hoyt Institute of Fine Arts in New Castle, Pennsylvania, and Principal Gallery, both in Alexandria and Charleston. She's received the Strauss Fellowship Grant from Fairfax County, Virginia. And so I want to go ahead and bring her out today because I want her to have a chance to talk about her work. So today I want to welcome Judith Peck. Judith, say hello so that I know you're still with me.
Hi, Tamarah. I'm really happy to be here.
Great. I'm happy to have you here. I really have enjoyed just admiring all your artwork and sharing it. And I want to, because my show comes from an inspirational point of view, I want you to share a little bit about did you dabble with creativity as a child? Were you an artist as a child?
Yes. Definitely, I've always been an artist, but I think all children are artists.
Yeah, that's true. Did your parents notice at some point that you had a special talent? Was there someone in your family that noticed that, or?
Well, both my parents could draw, and so well. And I thought when you grow up, you could read and draw.
So you just grew up thinking that. Okay. Well, what is your first memory that you have of art? Is there something that stands out still today? Like that sometimes we have memories of our childhood that will still stand out. Something that told you were fascinated with art.
Yes. My mother loved to go to museums and would take me as a baby. I remember in my stroller going to museums. And I was really taken with the Guernica by Picasso, which is probably an odd painting for a baby to admire, but it was huge, and it was full of action, and it was exciting, and my mom liked Picasso, and so we looked at that, and I remember I still have that as an inspiration for me.
That's great. Did she talk to you a lot about art and artists or history
yes.
at all?
Yeah.
So that's great. I mean, that is a blessing that you have that your mom had that, you shared that with her. But what, before you, were there other artists in your family besides your, I like to share this because some of our viewers, you know, some people think because there's no one in their family history that has a certain talent that they themselves won't have that talent. I know I was guilty of that growing up. And then vice versa. Is there any other history in your family of art, even if it's not just painting?
Yeah, we're all like either lawyers or in the arts. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so you said lawyers?
Yeah, my two brothers are lawyers, and relatives are musicians and composers and in all different fields in the arts, yeah.
Yeah, so you've got a lot of different art, but see, I have a lot of lawyers, friends who are lawyers, and I always tell them depending on the type of lawyer, they have a certain level of creativity. They just use it in a different way. And so they also have to be actors in the courtroom. So I've witnessed that. So for sure. But the work that you do on the broken plaster shards, I wanted you to share a little bit about this and how this idea came to you, as well as the meaning behind it. Because I know I was reading there's some family history there with your grandparents.
Right. Two of my grandparents came to the United States in the 20s, 1920s, as orphans from Russia. And I think they came because they were orphaned because of the May laws, which broke up all the towns that they were in. And they brought the shards with them, I felt. And they didn't talk about their family. So I started painting about my family history before I started painting about world history and now more personal present time. But the beginning was that I painted a family piece with broken shards, and it applied to the whole world situation. So I continued that technique.
Uh-huh. Now, do you have anything that you can show with that? This, I was thinking this might be a good time.
Sure, the painting behind me.
Yeah.
I could show that. I don't know how.
Because that was. Yeah.
So if you could see that there's shards embedded in the gesso layer and then put on board and then painted in oil.
And what inspired, what moved you about this particular subject? Because I noticed you used, I believe you used her in several pieces of work. You did a series of her, and it was in this, the actual art, American Art Collector that I discovered you in.
Yeah. The model is a well-known artist model named Pigeon Plumtree. And I'm using her in this whole series because I'm painting about similar but different topics as I go through the series, and I thought it would combine the series. And to me, Pigeon is more like a universal image. She represents all races and all women, and I think she works for the series very well.
Yeah, she's very beautiful, and I enjoyed that series.
You've had
her, you know, I noticed. You had several of them in this issue. When you work with someone like that, do you like to study them somewhat? We have that ability so much now with social media to really observe someone. Is that?
Well, I've worked with Pigeon for 3 or 4 years now, and or more, and I've gotten to know her, and I really am fond of her, and I have a relationship that, you know, give and take, and she inspires a lot of the work as well. So we talk about things in our lives, and some of the ideas for the paintings grow out of that.
Right. Well, I wanted to quote you because you had said the paintings are about the more universal message of meaning and preciousness of life, healing a broken world. These works became guides to explore the challenges that speak to the core of one's existence. My hope is that their penetrating gaze will move the viewer out of complacency. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Or
sure. Sure. I think that it's the artist's obligation to reach people with a message. And my message is that we're all the same. We have all the same hopes and dreams. And if we bring those shards together, we can heal the world. And so I look at things that are happening in the world and I'm concerned about it. And so I paint about it.
Right. So that's how you get a lot of your inspiration. And that's what I like about your work so much, because I have another quote here that you said, "My focus is to explore universal truths. People are fundamentally the same in every culture throughout time. Our hopes and dreams have not changed." I thought that was a beautiful quote.
Thank you.
I like that. But what inspires you to create usually your next piece of work? Is it something that, are you moved immediately by, is it a model or more of an emotion or something that is you're experiencing at a given time, even if it's not the outside world, but something in your world?
Yeah, usually it's something that I read about, or I read a poem, or I get inspirations from all different things. Maybe I've experienced something personal that I could see is more than personal. It becomes a bigger image. Like in this painting, it's called Steeled, and it's about trying to have an answer ready if something happens to you, like you're ready for whatever transpires. And so you have to have, you feel like when you're put in a situation, you already have an answer, which is not a welcoming situation. So that's what, you know, so I feel like this is isolating and alone, but you have to be ready for anything that transpires, because you are isolated.
Right, exactly.
I felt that way, and I think the model had felt that way.
So you had that connection. Mm-hmm. Well, I wanted you, because I'm trying to visualize how you, because you, I know when we met on Skype or Google Chat, whatever, you were very passionate about this technique you use of the shards, and how does that come together? Because you've got the broken pieces. I'm just trying to visualize it. Can you explain how that process is? Or?
Sure. I make a plaster sheet. I throw some plaster on a piece of paper, really, and I make a sheet of it, and then I break up the pieces. And I have a board ready, which I've done rabbit skin glue and gesso, true gesso on, and sanded those layers. And then I put the plaster on and then put more layers of gesso. And so then I have a couple of these boards, and then I choose which size and shape, but I try to make the plaster have a direction, and then I paint on it with oils. And it's a very long process of sanding and putting making true gesso. And it's a very long process, but I think that it works with these pieces. It gives it a richness of texture. And sometimes when you can't even see the plaster shards until you get up close to the painting, which is what I want. I want the image to hold everything together.
Right. It's beautiful. And I love, how do you choose? Because I believe I read in your bio, if I'm not mistaken, you don't use this for every piece. So what determines, which art determines this, whether or not you'll use this process?
It's usually the message that I have in the painting.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then as far as, or because I noticed you've done a lot of like portraits as well. Are any of these commissions? And do you do commissions?
Rarely I do commissions. If someone owns my work and then wants me to do a particular painting, I'll do a commission as a favor, but not normally.
Right. Well, how do you keep, what keeps you moving forward and like on a day-to-day basis and inspires you to constantly evolve with your work, so to speak?
I think I'm just excited about being in front of the easel. And I just enjoy it so much, and I'm always reading and exploring and doing cultural things, and I go to a lot of museums, and I really love looking at new art and everything.
Right. Well, how do you see your work evolving in the direction you're going to over the years ahead? Is there do you feel like you're moving into a different direction with it, or just a new level, or?
I just lost the question.
Oh, okay. How do you see your work evolving over the years ahead? Like, is it moving into a different direction? Are you constantly, do you feel like you're at a place where you're moving into a different level, or it's changing somewhat, or?
I think that my work is constantly changing, and I'm really excited about that. That's what makes me happy, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. That's good. Well, do you see, is there anything that you can, if you were to describe it to someone, of how it is evolving or moving, how would you describe that?
Well, I think there's always a common thread that goes through the work, and I think it's social justice, which is what I really paint about.
Uh-huh.
But, I think the world is changing, and it's constantly evolving, and so I can't help but be present and watch what's happening and have my work go there.
That's good. I mean, I really have enjoyed looking at your work, and it's just so beautiful, and it is very unique. And so I wanted you to share also, because for my viewers that are perhaps maybe they're aspiring artists, and I know this is a common problem because I'm more of an artist of photography, and I've always been a creative person, so I can, from my own experiences, and I know this is an experience a lot of artists have, how do you handle or get through periods of what we would say that block, the artist block, with your creativity? How do you rejuvenate yourself, and how do you work through those moments?
I have to be honest, I don't really have a block or a situation where I have blocks, but I do go to a lot of museums, plays, cultural things that I think always inspire me. I think that helps. And I think that an artist without culture, you can't produce culture. So you have to keep filling up.
Right. I agree. I mean, like I have to do things like I go to the, you know, I go view art, I go to the symphony, I've interviewed so many artists that alone keeps me rejuvenated, inspired, because we learn from other artists, even whether it's a musician or a painter or a sculptor or whatever, but just some of the, I guess for me, what I was thinking is when you have that block of more of an emotional block, like for me, I might just have to step outside and go for a walk for a few minutes. I guess that's what I'm, you know, because I think we all experience, I guess in my, just interviewing a lot of artists, they have had experiences of where they have to do something just to sort of rejuvenate themselves to when they feel a moment of, I just call it a block, you know. It doesn't have to be a serious block, but.
Yeah, also travel is great. I think to expose yourself to everything that's out there. I travel a lot and I enjoy that.
Yeah, well that helps too, and it does. And would you say some of your best works have come from times in your life where you were struggling with certain areas in your life, whether it's emotions or experiences, or is sometimes, do you feel like your best work is when things are going great?
I think I've had a pretty easy life, so so I think that I think I could have the most empathy, which is what painting is all about, I think, when I meet people and hear them and see them.
That sometimes helps you with your greatest works.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there a particular movement or time period in your career as an artist that really stands out that you feel like, wow, that was a time where I was greatly inspired, or more strongly than another period? Or
I think the present time.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's best for me. I really am enjoying it, and I'm really painting a lot.
But that's good. See, I think that's what, you know, because I'm just a very hopeful person, and I'm very inspired by just everything that's going on in the world today, because while there a lot of people see some sadness, I think there's a lot of happiness too, because there's a lot of changes, and I see people moving into acceptance, and I don't know, I think it just moves me to see people changing, you know, in general.
Yeah,
so
it moves me to see people involved, and I think that's what is big right now. I'm actually painting a lot of protest painting.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, I can't wait to see those. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. Well, who would you say has been some of your greatest influences in art, would you say?
I think Rembrandt and Velázquez and Sorolla, like all the Flemish artists. I have a list so I don't forget Sargent and Hals and Klimt.
Uh-huh.
N.C. Wyatt. They're real big for me.
And Picasso was a big influence when you were really young.
Yes, because he did paint really important works, like the Guernica.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do you have a current project that you're, say, working on today, or that you have plans to work on? I know you're doing the protest. Is that your biggest project right now, or is there anything else in the works? Or
yeah, I have a small painting. I haven't titled it yet. It's coming along, and I have a larger piece that I'm working on that I just started. And those are just two of the paintings that are on my easel right now.
Oh, that's great. Now, the protest, I would think that would be a good one on the broken shards. Is that how you want to approach that work? Or
definitely, definitely.
Yeah, I can see that for sure.
There are a lot darker paintings. If this is colorful, that one's darker.
Okay. Well, how does color come into play with each of your work? Does it sort of evolve as you're working on it? or is it do you have that, is it an intention that's already set before you begin?
I actually use a limited palette. So basic colors, and then it evolves. I keep working it. I work the whole painting as a whole, and I keep working it and glazing it and scratching it out and fighting with the painting.
Basically. Yeah. Well, what kind of advice would you give to, say, an aspiring artist, some wisdom that's helped you grow over the years?
I think that you have to paint what is really true to you. I think everybody has their own vision, and you shouldn't copy anybody. You should just make sure that the work is the best in your eyes and keep on going with that. When I started painting figurative work, I think mostly abstract was only the acceptable form. And I just kept doing it. I think that eventually it has come around, so figurative art is more at the forefront now, but it took a while. And I've been painting for more than 30 years.
Yeah. Well, you can tell. I mean, yeah, you certainly can tell. Well, I'm excited about your upcoming works. And also, I wondered if you had, because I always like to ask this, if there's like a dream exhibit, a dream place that you, a gallery or something that you would like to exhibit your work that you have not yet, you know, been exposed to.
I'd like a museum solo show.
Is there a particular museum that you...
Any museum would do.
And where is your next exhibit?
I have a show coming in Denver. I just have one piece in this A. Ben Gallery, Sight Unseen. Uh-huh. The reception is February 24th, but I also have an invitational coming up in March and a juried exhibit in March in Fredericksburg, and one in Washington and one in Florida, and then the Masur Museum is in April. So I've got a bunch of shows coming up.
Great, that's great. Now, how do you feel about social media and because that's really been a game changer for a lot of artists, and everybody has their different view. It's you know, from the people that I've talked to, it's great, but it's very, very, it's like another job to stay on top of it, promoting and using social media. How has it helped you, and how do you utilize it, I guess?
I think it's wonderful for artists because it's a very visual thing, and Facebook and now Twitter even, and Instagram, you're allowed to put your work up. And so it's connected me with other artists who've juried me into shows because of it. And people have found me that way and bought my work. So it's been really wonderful because artists are pretty lonely. We sit in our studio 24 hours a day. So it's nice to be able to connect to other artists.
That's great. Yeah, I think it's been fabulous. I think the biggest thing is, from what I've had with other artists and, you know, musicians, actors, everything, it's if you utilize it, it's great. It is like another little part-time job, though, to stay on top of it. And that's, I think, the biggest thing. But it is great exposure. because it is very visual. So I think that's great. Well, Judith, is there anything else that you wanted to mention today? We've gone through all the questions.
I just wanted to show you these little things that I've been doing lately.
Okay.
These are some of the things that I paint for just for fun, to have a break from my other paintings. I don't know if you can see this, but little silver leaf paintings with this one has a bee on it. And here's a little one with a skull.
Oh, I love the skull. Now I have to quit talking because it just came back on me, the camera.
And here's a little bird, a crow.
Those are gorgeous. And what is that on? Is
silver leaf.
Silver leaf.
So there are little boards, little...
That is beautiful.
Yeah. So I'm donating some of these to some art auctions and things like that.
Oh, that's great. Oh, those are beautiful. Those are beautiful. I did want to show these, though. I forgot I had these because I think one of these are some self-portraits. And I believe, didn't you win an award for this one? Or
I might have. I don't remember.
You don't remember? And then this one, I really like this one. This is on your bio.
Oh, yeah.
Now, is this a similar, is this what was on the first one you showed, the little, can you see that?
Yeah.
This little.
That's called the White Rose.
Uh-huh.
And it was a historical painting about the White Rose Society.
Yeah. This is beautiful. I really like both of these. So I wanted to show those. And is there anything that you have coming up that you wanted to mention and or talk about that we didn't cover? Is there something you'd like to share?
I've got this really interesting show that was an invitational. It's called Alchemical Vessels. It's coming up in Washington, D.C., but I thought you would be interested in hearing about it because it's a show about healing. In this, the whole premise is that you take a vessel and you make something that is now new and a healing vessel. And so what I did, in keeping with the work that I do, is I took a vessel and I broke it. And then I painted on it, and then I painted the Japanese art of gluing those pieces together and making something finer out of the broken piece. So all of the cracks have gold in them. And it's beautiful.
Now tell me what you mean when you're saying you're painting on the vessel.
Yeah, I took I broke this piece and I joined the pieces together.
Okay.
And also painted an image on the vessel.
Wow. And that's going to be in Washington, you said?
Yeah, it's at the Smith's Center for Healing Arts. And it'll be on my website. The link will be on my website. And people can bid on these. Or they get, if they have a ticket, then they get one of the vessels, actually.
And when is the actual exhibit?
I think it's in April.
April, okay. Okay.
Or maybe March. March, I think it's in March. And March 1st, the tickets go on sale March 1st.
Yeah, I'll have to, I'll make sure I get that from you because I'll have a replay of this in my blog. So I'll have all your links in there as well. And so make sure I get that, and I'll keep checking your website as well. You'll probably put that on Facebook too, won't you?
Yeah, I will when it comes up. There's a link on it on my website already.
Okay. I'll make sure I have all those links. Is there is there anything else you want? Because I know you had to be you've got 7 minutes. You said, yeah. Is there anything else that you wanted to share that we didn't go over?
Good. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I really enjoyed talking to you.
Good. I've enjoyed having you here today. Your work is just absolutely stunning, and I'm looking forward to continuing following you and sharing your work. So don't hesitate to tap me on the shoulder on Facebook and let me know when you've got a new piece, or tag me on it, because I like continually sharing my guest work. And since I've interviewed so many people, it gets harder and harder to keep up with everybody. So I definitely want to keep up with your work. And it's been very inspirational to me as well. And I know other people have enjoyed it on my list. So I'm sure you're going to have some new fans.
Anybody have any questions, they can always email me or ask me on Facebook.
Great. And you can, her Judith's website is judithpeck.net. So that's her last name is P-E-C-K, judithpeck.net. And there'll also be a replay of this on YouTube and on Tamarah's Closet YouTube channel. And I'll also have her links as well as a replay of this interview on my blog at tamarahscloset.com. So please share this interview so that I can continue to celebrate Judith and her beautiful work. Join me next week as I'll be interviewing a fabulous saxophonista from Italy for a fantastic, he's with a fantastic jazz marching band. His name is Dario Cecchini. And to my viewers, to your own success, just keep on rocking it, and we'll see you next week.